Hi guys, so firstly let's start with communication. Communication occurs between minimum two speakers, that is there is a speaker and a receiver. And in cases of global aphasia, this ability of communication is completely lost. So while rehabilitation of aphasias, you are supposed to keep in mind that you are treating communication domain at both the receivers as well as the speakers. So I am aware that we all are aware that there are many approaches like MIT, VAT, PACE, AAC, etc. But you need to remember that clinically, there is no cookbook for aphasia therapy. And according to the patient, from each patient to patient, there is a different angle and a perspective to them. So you need to tailor-make your way of therapy for each patient. So for this particular question, we reached out to a clinical expert who has been working in aphasiology since few years. And the following answer that I'll be sharing with you all is their perspective of how they would treat a clinically global aphasia case. So let's look at the answer.
I would like to speak in overall core 3 points: general domain, some approaches, and verbal output stimulation. First, let's go to general domain. First is the awareness of the problem.
So it's very important that this is first step is taken care of well, as many of the patients might have a denial or they might be unaware of their problem. So first you would work on creating that awareness to the patient as well as general counseling to the caregivers.
Next, you will go on to improve the communication intent of the patient.
Just as in a child case where building a communication intent is the first step, here also this is a very, very crucial step. So you cannot just go in with a VAB and the medical reports that you get and just start with, is this your name, and expect the patient to answer yes, no, and cooperate with you. So firstly, knowing the likes and dislikes of the patient and going on to the patient level to create a communication intent is a very, very important step. So some patient might be a banker, some might be a musician. So if it's a musician, you will talk to him about music so that he feels like talking. So making them feel like to talk is creating a communication intent.
Next comes the counseling of the caregivers.
So as said in the beginning, communication is a two-way process at a speaker and a receiver's end. So here we are giving some counseling and some strategies to the receiver end to better improve the communication. So you're counseling the caregiver to use some strategies, simple like using polar questions. So instead of asking what do you want for breakfast, if you ask do you want dosa or idli, it is easier for the patient to understand and thus it will be better communication between the two. Also, you need to allow patient time, give patient time to respond. Their processing is really slow and their latency of response is huge. So you should let them process your question and give them more time to answer. Also, you need to remember to speak slowly and use simple sentences while you're communicating with the patient. Next point can be use of contextual things to talk about instead of any abstract things. So instead of talking about do you remember our marriage or do you remember our children, you can speak about something which the patient can see around himself in his immediate surroundings.
Next comes the communication therapy strategies for the patients and caregivers.
So for this, what you can do is firstly you need to assess the baseline mode of communication for the patient. That is, since the patient might be non-verbal, you can decide on whether the patient is able to point well or if he is able to do simple eye blinks or gestures are possible for the patient. So this is going to be helpful for the comprehension level. For the expression level, their basic need of expression can be as simple as just calling out to the caregiver or asking for food. So tailor make some approaches and you can make a way out of yourself to work on those aspects. Just for example, you can use operant conditioning, like if the patient has to call out to the caregiver, you can place a ring or a bell next to the patient. Every time physically you will prompt the patient to use that bell and the caregiver who will be standing at the door will come as the patient presses the bell. So every time when this keeps on happening, slowly you are going to fade away your physical prompt and thus train the patient to ring a bell whenever he needs and the caregiver will come to them.
Next, let's look at the second core aspect, that are some basic approaches. Considering the patient is non-verbal, first let's move on to gesture identification and gesture production.
So what you can do for gesture identification is you can use any of the flashcards or a written stimuli would also do in front of the patient, and you are supposed to ask him that to point at the appropriate or target gesture. For this, you can use auditory plus written plus tactile stimulus, or also you can use physical prompts, and slowly you fade all these prompts away and patient has to identify what is this. Next comes the production. So using the same materials, you are going to point out to a particular gesture and he has to imitate it, you can give them physical prompts and he has to do that gesture. It can be as simple as saying a hi bye or giving a salute or doing a namaste. It can be any of it.
Next, you would move on to picture matching, first with similar and then different pictures. Moving on to object matching, similarly same or different. Make a note that this is a very basic skill and does not require any linguistic domain, and the pictures that you can use can be tailor-made as per patients. Next, you move on to spoken to picture matching followed by spoken to written matching. Here you need to note the linguistic component has been added, which was not there earlier.
So from here on, the expert has suggested that he would use a cognitive neuropsychological approach for the same. Now, what does this mean and how to go about it? Suppose you have a target picture in mind as cat. Now, patient is supposed to match your spoken word cat to the picture down below. So initially, you're going to place a few cards. First, you're going to use distant semantic pictures. That is, you can put a banana, a glass, and a cat. And then, so it's easier for the patient to identify a cat. Next, you will move on to the closer category, closer semantic pictures like a cat, a tiger, and a dog. And out of that, patient will have to point out to the cat. So this way, you will go in a hierarchy. This we did with the picture matching. Similarly, you can go for verbal sequential commands or commands like just simple as switch off the light or open your phone. Similarly, as we did with pictures, you can generalize it to this as well.
Next, you can move on to modified approach semantic feature.
So semantic features is used for improving the comprehension. So what you can do here is you can keep the target picture in the center, and then you're going to use target features and distracting features. So, and you're going to give cues relating and pointing to the target features so that the patient comes to the target name. Okay, so for example, suppose take the example of cat itself. So if your target word is cat, you can use other two various categories like animal and a food. And you are going to point out to the target feature of animals so that it is easier for the patient to comprehend cat. So in this way also, first you use the pictures and then you can generalize it to sequential commands and following verbal commands.
Moving on to the last core point, that is verbal output stimulation. Initially, you can use the tasks for singing and humming, like play music and, you know, playing patient's favorite songs. Then you can go on to automatic speech like number counting or days of the week or some lyrics of some songs. And further, you can continue with the semantic oddman outs like semantic category sorting task, formal singing therapy, then MIT and further so on. So, conclusion is you have a lot of recipes available in the market. However, choosing the right and appropriate one based on patient is a clinician's charm. Reading more would really help, and towards the end, we have provided some resources given by other experts. You can go through those reading materials. In global aphasia, target the communication and caregiver counseling first. Then get their interest in the therapy. And then you can do MIT, VNEST, semantic feature analysis, and a lot more approaches.
So, hope you guys found this video useful and hope you learned something, because I definitely personally learned a lot from this. We would thank our experts whom we reached out and who helped us in this video. Thank you everyone. Happy learning.